Hello everyone and welcome to Webcast Wednesday from Solid Solutions. The title of the webcast today is Splines, Splines and More Splines, and your presenter today is Pete Harkness. So I'll hand you over to Pete. Hi Pete.
Hi, thank you Charlie, and good afternoon to everyone listening. As Charlie said, this is our webcast on splines, and we're going to have a little look at the few different options that we've got. There's, you know, some new things have come in 2014 as well, which are hopefully going to be interesting for you to see. The spline tool, from what I've picked up from customers, it's something that I think a lot of people see the place for it but maybe struggle to use it. It's not too intuitive to use, while this new type of spline will hopefully sort of sort out all of those problems of the past. So for today's agenda on splines, we'll start off just by looking at these types of splines that we've had in the previous years in SolidWorks. We've got the standard spline, which is just shown in the picture up at the top right. We've got spline on surface, which is obviously this image of a spline on surface down here in the bottom left. And then we've got fit spline, which allows you to take bits of geometry from an existing sketch, fit a spline on top of it, and then it converts that geometry into a single spline. So they're the things that we've always had in SolidWorks. But new to 2014, we have these style splines. Now the style spline is derived from the Bezier curve, designed to generate a smooth continuous curve defined by its manipulation handles. So those sort of control points and center line sketches that you see around the spline in that image, with the style spline, that's actually what you draw. So instead of you drawing the spline and placing points along it, you draw these handles around the spline for it to then generate the spline. And we've also got a new little dimension to complement all types of spline, which really brings the tool alive in my opinion. Knowing the length of a spline or controlling the length of it used to be something that we couldn't really do, but now we can. It gives you a great idea for things like maybe you've got wires or cabling just going through a particular part or assembly. Now you can just estimate what the length of all of that is going to be. So it's very useful for getting extra information out of the model. I'll just switch across to SolidWorks. And to begin with, I'm going to open up a new part. And just to introduce, we're going to just have a look at what a spline is, what it does, how we can use it. So this is the spline tool up in the sketch tab of the command manager. That's just the standard spline that we've always had. And you can see if I just start clicking, it places these points, and depending on where I put the points, the spline takes a sort of a route of best fit between those points. If I right-click that spline, there's a whole load of options for the splines. We can turn on control polygons. Now these look very similar to the style spline, but hopefully, as you'll see later on, they are actually, couldn't be more different in what you can do with them. But with the normal spline, control polygon allows you to just drag these around and changing the shape of the spline. Pretty much all of the options for splines do live on the right-click menu. So if I just turn off my control polygons, we've got another option to show inflection points. So the points along the spline where it changes direction. We can also indicate the minimum radius of curvature, so which is the tightest point of the spline, just to check maybe we have a value in mind that we don't want the curvature or the radius to drop below. So you can easily find where that is and maybe adjust the point to look at the next lowest value. And we've also got this ability to show curvature cones. Yeah, so they indicate how nicely the shape transitions between one curve to the next. So for example, just studying what we've got here, coming around the top of the spline, this is a really smooth transition. The length of these cones isn't changing particularly greatly, and you can follow like a nice smooth curved edge. Whereas in contrast to that, at this particular point down here, we've got a little lump, and that could be something that you'd look to address if you're using the spline for, you know, to create a nice curvature continuous surface that will render really nicely or look like a very smooth, aesthetically pleasing consumer product. Reflections in a render, for instance, would, you know, ripple over this little bump. So it allows you to just preempt that, so you don't have to build the whole model, render it, find the problem out then, and then come all the way back. On the drop-down next to the spline, there are, again, a few things that have always been there. We've got equation-driven curves. That is really a completely different thing to splines. I know a lot of people say, well, why is it in there? From my memory, equation-driven curve used to live in the curves drop-down, but they've moved its place to now come into splines. You should also be seeing fit spline in this menu. But that has just dropped out for 2014, but they are looking to bring that back in to the drop-down. The command itself does still live in its proper place in tools, spline tools and fit spline. So it is still there. But then here's this new one, the style spline. And that's what we're going to have a little look at next. Now I've just shown you some of the options on that particular spline. Now I've got a very basic part, really, really simple. It's a ski. Our office ski trip is coming up in the next few days, so we're all pretty excited. So I chose to make a ski. From the side profile, of course, a ski comes down and it then curves back up towards the center. So it's a perfect type of shape that we could create using the spline. Now, to make the sketch for that, again, I'll start off in a new part. What I'll do to just compare and contrast between the two new types of spline we've got, first of all, I'll try and make that shape using the standard spline tool. So I'd look to start off over here somewhere, place a point, maybe bring that up a little bit. And then just curve it back up at the other side. Now you can start adding relations to these points, making bits of them horizontal. And I can start clicking the spline, playing around with these spline handles to adjust quite how curvy it is or the angle. But really, to build up that shape with the standard spline, it's going to be a lot of work compared to using the style spline. I'd probably look to add some construction lines or some reference geometry to help me define the shape at this point, because otherwise it can be very difficult to come out with something that is a logical shape. I will just pay a little bit of attention to these spline handles. It's worth pointing out different features along the length of the handle. There's a little diamond on the handle, and if you click the diamond, that allows you to adjust the angle on its own. There's an arrowhead, and I can use that to adjust the influence of the spline handle. But then there's a tiny little ball at the end, a little dot, and that allows you to move the influence and the angle all at once. What I'd say is that it's best, you know, to have a little bit more control over what you're doing, to just adjust the angle and then the influence individually with the diamond and then the little arrowhead. So that's just a nice little tip for anyone who's looking to use this sort of spline. I'll just minimize that document for the moment and bring up another new part. And I'll just look at how I'd go about sketching that side profile of my ski with the new style spline. So there it is in the drop-down. I'll pick that. And as I said, instead of drawing the spline I'm now drawing the control polygons around the spline. So if I start my sketch on the left-hand side again, maybe come just about over here, back down to the middle. I'll just try and make that sort of roughly symmetrical on both sides. So already I seem to have built up a much more uniform shape by drawing it in this way. What is excellent about this new feature is that we can add relations, the full range of relations to these control polygons, whereas the control polygon on the normal spline, you can't do that. So you can't add as much information onto the model to define it and drive it to the shape you want. We do want this to be roughly symmetrical towards the front side and the back, so I can pop a center line in and then I'll hold control and pick a similar point from either side of the center line and then the center line itself, and it will allow me to add the symmetric relation. So if I repeat that for all of the similar points, and the point in the middle, I'll just make sure that it is, it is stuck to the center line coincident. What it means, now we've got the symmetric relations on, is that you can just make changes to one side and it will update the shape on the other. So already this is looking a lot more controlled. All of the sort of interrogation methods for splines that I showed you in the previous example, they're still all here for the style spline, so you can right click and again there you've got show inflection points, show minimum radius, and show your curvature cones, so you can turn all of that on for the spline, the style spline, sorry. I'll add a dimension just to give this some scale. Now, I know my skis are about 175, so I'll just put that in as 175. And, well, that, I suppose, in its own way, is another subtle feature of 2014. Maybe, you know, if you've used previous versions of the software, you'll remember where you draw a very complicated sketch shape, and then you add a dimension that will make one element a lot bigger, and the whole sketch just sort of turns in on itself and makes a bit of a mess. In 2014, as you add the first dimension to your sketch, it just scales all of the other sketch elements in relation to that first dimension. So we now no longer have that situation where we mess up our sketches on applying the first dimension. I maybe would like to get a bit more control over the shape of the ski towards the middle. And you can right-click on the control polygon around the outside, and you can say to insert control vertex, and then you can simply click, and it just adds an extra point for you to control the model with. So if I make them symmetrical as well about my center line, I can now just have that extra little bit of control here to manipulate the model how I like. Yeah, let's drop that down. And it does just give you so much more control than we've had previously. Now this is where I'll introduce that new dimension that we have for splines. I said it allows you to dimension the chord length of the spline, so actually the length of it itself. But this is a surprisingly good example. I've surprised myself here because when we go Smart Dimension and click to add, and I'll just accept the value that it is, 183, it's really good because if I were to be designing a ski, you know, I know the overall length is going to be 175, but I may not know how long the material is, say for the layers of fiberglass, or maybe there's a vinyl layer on the ski, a plastic layer. You know, what's the true length of this if it had been flattened? So what's the length of material I'm going to need to cover that? And this is the cord length, which, as I said before, is really useful for things like cabling as well, to get an impression of, am I going to need 10 meters of cabling, or do I just need one? I won't dwell on that for too much longer. What I think I'm going to do is just a quick little extruded surface. And yeah, we'll just go 10 on there. So it's taken the shape of the ski. And with this example, I'll just show you the spline on surface command. So in Sketch, again, the drop down next to spline, we've got spline on surface. Ideally, we'll pick the surface before we go into the command. And then we can just start drawing the spline. And it just sticks it directly onto the surface, so its curvature matches that of the surface. With not very much work, we can check that the ends are coincident there to the edge of our surface. We can apply relations to the handles to make sure that they're looking vertical or horizontal. The reason why the model went red there and we had that little error is that as I've adjusted just one of those handles, the line of best fit or the spline hangs off the edge of the surface. So until I added the second relation in on the other side, it isn't symmetrical, so it just sort of falls off the edge, which is why you get the little error. But once you've put the other one in, it's fine. And again, for the spline handles up at the top, I'll just click the spline handle and add an along Z relation to make sure that it's staying sort of horizontal. Something a lot of people don't realize as well about splines is that you can dimension the spline handles. Yeah, just go Smart Dimension and click that spline handle. Yeah, you give that any value you want to just control the amount of influence it has. So let me come out of the sketch, and on the Surfaces tab of the Command Manager, I'll just go into the Trim Surface command and use that sketch as the trim tool, and then just tell it to remove those two little chunks of surface up at the end. And now it's taken on the shape of our ski. Now, because I'm super lazy, instead of modeling all of that again on the other side, of course we can't just mirror it because it's in a 3D sketch, and you can only mirror in a 2D sketch. I'll use Trim Surface just to chop off half of that and then go into Mirror. And because of the way you've built it, I mean, that was one continuous entity. You can be sure that it does have continuous curvature across there. Using the Knit command up on the Surfaces tab of the Command Manager, we'll bring those two surfaces together into one. And then we can just thicken it to whatever we want. And we've turned that into a solid model. So it's a really quick and easy way to have quite a lot of control over the shape you're drawing with that new style spline. We've looked at the dimension and we've had a little look at spline on surface. There is one option that we haven't had a look at, which is our fit spline. And I've just got a little training example here just to demonstrate that to anyone who hasn't seen the feature. What I'd be looking to do is I've built up this shape. I've got a 3D sketch over here. I've now got a helix and spiral. And then this is actually a separate projected curve all of its own. At 90 degrees to my path, I've drawn a little circle. And I'm going to do a sweep, so I'll go into swept surface. I'm going to pick that profile, and then I'll pick the path. Ah, well, what do we have here? Precisely, what we discover is that even when using, say, the selection manager to try and pick multiple entities, you can only sweep along elements from one sketch. and this is where Fit Spline becomes a great tool for you. If we open up a 3D sketch, we can go to our Tools, Spline Tools, and find that Fit Spline command, and then just pick all of the entities that we want to fit the spline to. And it makes it one loop, so you clear the option for closed spline. We have got a tolerance box on the left if we want to, you know, say it needs to be a really fine tolerance that it matches the existing geometry. But that should be absolutely fine for this example. We'll click OK. And if I come out of the 3D sketch and we try that swept boss base again, here the preview generates and I'm able to accept the feature and it's created itself absolutely no bother. I suppose the second little benefit of using the fit spline in that situation, instead of maybe using a compound curve to join all of those sketches together, is that because the spline is one continuous entity, you don't get any ridges along the sweep path. I open up the completed example. Well, I can't because I've deleted it. That's all right. Let's just delete the sweep feature and I will just show you compound curve or composite curve. And we just pick the entities that we want to join. So again, it's just all of those bits in here. That's a 3D sketch with my spline in still getting in the way of my selection. There we go, that's now created a compound curve, and we could go ahead and use that for a sweep instead of using fit spline. But on the preview, you see there's those little rings that I was talking about across all the transitional sections that the fit spline doesn't present you with. So for rendering or for product images, the fit spline allows you to get a really nice, smooth and complete result. As I said, I'll just reinforce that fit spline should live in this drop-down list, but just temporarily for 2014, it's gone missing. They do intend to bring it back. A little tip of mine, if ever you struggle to find a command, use this little search box up in the top of SolidWorks. If you set it to commands, and then just start typing the name of what you're looking for, it brings it up in a list. If you're not sure where that lives, let me just think of a good one that's hidden somewhere. Sketch picture is one I always forget where it is. Of course, you've got to be in a sketch to use a sketch picture. So there it is. We can either click it in the list to go straight into that command, or I can push the little glasses on the right-hand side and it expands my menus and points to it with a big red arrow. So that wasn't me opening those menus up. It just does it for you to show you where it lives. And that little search box up at the top is an absolute godsend. So you really don't have to remember where anything lives anymore. You just ask it to tell you. I can see there's a couple of little questions have come in. It's hard to go on for too long about spline, so I think I'll hand over to Charlie and then just try and address some of these questions. Thanks for listening though, guys.